Does anyone remember Vicky 1999? Well, he is the first person to accuse me of misgendering someone. In comedic honor of that claim, let's celebrate it by looking at another Marxist-Leninist guy. This one goes by the name of Spooky Scary Socialist, and his question of the day is, was Stalin really that bad? Gee, I don't know. Was Stalin that bad? I mean, you tell me, people. I'll leave the most trustworthy place to answer that, which is the comments section. But I think our SSS guy answered that for us with a simple no in the description. Imagine if Stalin was still alive today and saw that his cult of personality lives on. I mean, it definitely lives on in Russia, as their educational system is very much inclined towards that curriculum. But it sadly exists here too. Since people who never lived in the Soviet Union want to glorify it, let's, see what experience our infographics friend had when he lived in the 1950s.
So, Stalin has always been a contentious point for people in the left and the general public. And since my audience is virtually zero right now, it makes sense to make this video earlier instead of later. Whenever I tell anyone in real life that I'm a socialist, they always say something like, "Oh, so you support evil dictators that killed tens of millions of people like Stalin, right?"
Well, they're not wrong.
Back to the topic. I mean, who even was Stalin? There's all these mean rumors flying around and starting to hurt his feelings. What's fact and what's fiction? Yosef Rishnovich Dushkevili, hopefully I said that right, was born in 1878 in a small town in Georgia.
Okay, we know that. I'm sorry to stop you here, but we didn't come here for a biography lesson. Let's get to the dictatorial parts.
You can hear the rhetoric everywhere. Stalin killed 60 million people, or 50 million people, or 4. Basically, it isn't hard to find huge death counts in the tens of millions. But when you look deeper at these numbers, you'll begin to find that there are two camps. According to Europe of History by Norman Davies, Stalin killed around 50 million people. Let's keep that information tucked in our little chart here. According to that history judged by Roy Medvedev, Stalin killed millions. RJ Rummel says that 43 million is Stalin's death count. In Health and Social Change in Russia and Eastern Europe by William C. Cockerham, he says that Stalin killed at least 50 million people, citing Norman Davies from earlier. According to Stalinist Terror, New Perspectives, edited by Getty and Manning, there were only 9.5 million surplus deaths during the 1930s. And according to Victims of Soviet Terror, there were 8 to 9 million deaths during the 30s. Even if we adjust these estimates to apply only to the 1930s, there's still a huge difference with these estimates. The higher number camp has an average of 20 million deaths for the 1930s, while the lower number camp has 8.5 million deaths for the 1930s. What's up with this gap? Well, there are two main camps when it comes to Soviet history. One camp is the Cold War warriors, with extremely high estimates that criticize historians with lower estimates for defending Stalin and refusing to accept facts. The other camp is the revisionists, who have criticized the Cold War warriors for using secondhand sources and presenting hard-to-justify figures.
What kind of a retarded argument is this? His logic is that Stalin is good because he killed 8 million people and not 25 million people, which is how most historians put the estimate. But really, people say Hitler as the embodiment of evil because he killed 6 million people during the Holocaust. Imagine if he had a cult of personality of his own. I mean, he does, I mean, but these people are generally frowned upon. And yet they love Stalin because him killing 2 million people more is not bad. Well, I kind of spoke too soon, because he tries to defend that argument right now.
Side note, before we get into the numbers, it's easy to accuse lower estimators as irrationally defending Stalin. But it's ridiculous to do that, because 3 million deaths is not somehow better than 7 million deaths. There was obviously huge amounts of suffering, and trying to determine the historical record doesn't undermine that fact. What does it mean to be a death under Stalin? Some historians calculate the birth rate before Stalin and then the population after Stalin and use the deficit to calculate his death count. But this is not only an incredibly wrong way to count death, it also counts people who weren't born and ignores the fact that war and tumultuous periods typically lower birth rates. Other historians count famine deaths or World War II deaths as those killed by Stalin, while others only count overtly intentional killings. Others just seem to have used rumors or guesses to come up with their claims.
Holy cow. This guy really doesn't know how to calculate effects of mass killings. Maybe just look at the orders that Stalin had done through the NKVD and see what results were there. I mean, if you're ordering your secret police to kill people, that kind of counts as deaths under Stalin. But no, he'd rather blame the deaths on others. Imagine going up to a Holocaust survivor and telling them that it never happened. That's what this guy is.
However, archival evidence during this time has been released and cooled down the debate a bit. The paper, Victims of the Soviet Penal System in the Pre-War Years, uses official archival data to refute and confirm old conclusions, specifically about the Great Purges. According to the paper, the long-awaited archival evidence on the repression in the period of the Great Purges shows that the level of arrests, political prisoners, executions, and general camp populations tend to confirm the orders of the magnitude indicated by those labeled as revisionists and mocked by those proposing higher estimates. The paper goes on to refute old claims about the terror targeting specific nationalities and confirm that only a minority were imprisoned for political reasons. It also confirms that the purges mainly targeted elites and was characterized by general confusion. But if you truly want to appreciate how bloated Stalin's numbers can get, just take a look at this table from the paper. Most of the columns aren't filled out, so let's take a look at the 1937-38 total arrests and see the difference from reality and actual documentable data. Even if we assume that the documented archives are incorrect, adding a million deaths still wouldn't get anywhere close to the estimates of 20 million. The paper also goes on to roast the high estimate group by saying, "Mainstream published estimates of the total numbers of victims of repression in the late 1930s have ranged from Dmitry Volkogonov's 3.5 million to Olga Shatunovskaya's nearly 20 million. The bases for these assessments are unclear in most cases and seem to have come from guesses, rumors, or extrapolations from isolated local observation. As the table shows, the documentable number of victims are much smaller." The bloating of Stalin's death count into the tens of millions is not only historically inaccurate, but also in the direct interests of the ruling class. If someone bothers to complain about their working conditions, all they have to do is point at Stalin and say the alternative to capitalism is 60 million deaths and gulag camps. Speaking of which...
Now, he gives you a very big spreadsheet of Soviet statistics, but there are two problems here. One is that not all Soviet statistics have been released. The Russian government is very reluctant to release them. They're going to release a small amount of data up next in 2029. Second, if you actually look at the Antonov-Ovsenko data, you will note that those 19 million refer to a 5-year period in the 1930s, while the 2.5 million figure is taken from a 1-year period. What makes this even worse is that this distinction is shown in a footnote in frame, which he conveniently cut out when zooming in on the data. You have to ask this guy, why is he cutting out data? Well, it's documents that expose the killings, don't they?
I've got documents. I have documents on all of you. You, 13th of March, 1937, Zolotov trials, 42 dead, 173 exiled. Your signature. That's enough.
Yeah, well, you signed on the life of your own fucking brother.
Oh, you think that was easy, you bastard.
Back off, Gorev. How did your conscience accommodate that? And Zykov, poor blameless, guileless Zykov, all of you. All of you. I have documents on all of you.
Gulags are often compared to Nazi death camps, but this is an unfair comparison. According to the paper from earlier, when looking at official archival evidence, many of the inmates in the Gulag camps were freed and death rates were low. Only a minority of the inmates were convicted of being counter-revolutionary, with most being there for general crimes. Although it is important to take these distinctions with a grain of salt, this also opens up an important dialogue about why we shouldn't count all arrests in the Soviet penal system, because some were just arrests of general criminals that would have been arrested anyway in a Western society.
This is the first time in my life that I am seeing someone defend gulags and comparing them to legitimate prisons. Like, can I have some Tylenol? What this guy needs to learn is that a gulag refers to a forced labor camp where people receive no pay, no safety regulations, and are worked to death. It's essentially slavery. And to defend gulag is to basically defend slavery. While he's right that inmates varied from petty criminals to political criminals, that does not exclude the large numbers of inmates whose crimes were basic freedoms, such as speaking out against the state, practicing a religion, trying to leave, or anything that counted as counter-revolutionary behavior. All of the worst parts were under Stalin, when the mortality rate was 20% in the 1940s, as opposed to 0.4% in 1956. I wouldn't call this the attributes of a good person.
shoot her before him, but make sure he sees it. Or in this one, kill him, take him to his church, dump him in the pulpit. And I'll leave the rest up to you.
Oh my goodness. I mentioned this earlier, but I didn't think this would be here.
Many people love to point out that Stalin killed more than Hitler, but there are many issues in that statement. As we saw earlier, Stalin's death count can vary by tens of millions depending on what you count and the method you use to get it. Hitler killed around 11 to 25 million people, while Stalin killed anywhere from 3 to 50 million people. Sure, you could cherry-pick numbers to make Stalin look worse than Hitler, but the opposite's also true. So while saying Stalin killed more than Hitler is technically correct, I could say that Hitler killed more than Stalin and have that same sense of satisfaction.
Okay, he just said garbage. Nothing he mentioned states that Hitler was worse than Stalin. Okay, in what world did Hitler kill more than Stalin? I think that even with his lowest estimates, you can still agree that Stalin won the oppression Olympics game here. So in the next part, he debunks the argument that Hitler and Stalin were friends, which actually isn't true because Germany and the Soviet Union only signed a non-aggression pact. That part wasn't too important. But this next part is what I'm interested in.
For the pleb tier viewers who don't know what the Holodomor is, it's essentially a famine that took place in Ukraine from 1932 to 1933, often attributed to Stalin. However, many like to call the Holodomor a genocide caused by Stalin, and it's very strange to do that when there was already a poor harvest at the time. Stalin's policies did play a role in the famine, I'm not denying that. He requisitioned grain in large amounts, and this happened to affect Ukraine worse because they were an important agricultural center. However, this wasn't deliberately targeted at Ukraine, and this can be seen in the way that other parts of Russia suffered as well. Certain peasants also hoarded grain and slaughtered their own livestock to fight the collectivization movement.
Ah, it's one of those people who claim that the Holodomor wasn't man-made. He even tries to slide past it by connecting Stalin to it because he really was connected to it. But he also doesn't mention the intentional aspects, such as rejection of foreign aid, confiscation of all household foodstuff, and restriction of public movement, which really did contribute to that. 16 countries will even agree.
Imagine a country with near full employment, free healthcare, free education, and rough income inequality. Does that sound impossible? Well, it did exist.
It is possible, but the Soviet Union was not those things. But seriously, income equality? People had low salaries while the government stored all the wealth for themselves. That's communism. We're all equal because we're all poor, except for the elites.
It was the Soviet Union. While the United States and other capitalist countries were suffering from the Great Depression, the Soviet Union was doing fine and its planned economy was growing reliably each year.
That is until the economy stagnated and then started slowing down and then went down the drain, which is what led to the collapse of the Soviet Union.
Compared to the bigotry of the United States, the Soviet Union was also great in terms of race relations. As civil rights activist Paul Robeson put it, "In Russia, I felt for the first time like a full human being. No color prejudice like in Mississippi, no color prejudice like in Washington. It was the first time I felt like a human being." So, if you were a person of color, poor, or a member of the working class, you would actually be thriving in the Soviet Union.
Race equality? Is this guy illiterate? Look at the native populations of Siberia who have been subject to persecution for centuries. It increased during the Soviet Union and they're still heavily discriminated against in Russia today. Look at the Tatars, the native populations of Crimea who were forced from their homes, or the natives of Big Diomede Island who were forcibly displaced to make room for ethnic Russians. Where were the good relations then? And it's not just people inside the Soviet Union. People in its satellite states were all subject to this too. Like Kaliningrad, for example, it was actually German territory, but they were expelled by the Soviets after World War II. What a way to ignore history completely. I think he would be perfect as a propaganda minister. Now in this last part, he goes on a whataboutargument denouncing the US and trying to say that its problems are somehow as bad or worse than that of the Soviet Union. All the usual stuff we've seen before from people like this. If you need more explanations as to solidify Stalin as being an evil person, let's put aside the tens of millions of sufferings and focus on what kind of a relationship he had with people close to him, aka his family and friends. Khrushchev, for example, openly denounced Stalin and called him a dictator when he took power, a period known as de-Stalinization. Even Lavrenty Beria, who was known as the Soviet Union's Himmler, denounced him right after his death. Even his own family had issues with him. Stalin's first wife, Kato Svanze, sadly died of typhus only 18 months into the marriage, and at his funeral he stated that he would never love again. His second wife, Nadezhda Aleluyeva, actually shot herself because she couldn't take living with him. Stalin's children and grandchildren also didn't fare much better. Yakov Dugashvili was Stalin's first son from his first marriage, and the two had a really bad relationship. When Yakov tried to commit suicide after his father took apart his engagement, Stalin's reply was, "He can't even shoot straight." During World War II, Yakov was then taken prisoner during the Battle of Smolensk, and while in German captivity, he openly denounced his father's regime and spoke of the ills of the Soviet Union. In 1943, after the Battle of Stalingrad, the Soviets captured General Frederick Paulus, and when the Germans recommended a prisoner exchange to give Yakov back, Stalin declined. His son died in a prisoner of war camp later that year. Yakov then had two children. One of them was Yevgeny Dugashvili. He was a colonel in the Soviet Air Force, and he lived until his death in 2016, and he is the only member of Stalin's family to defend his father's regime. His daughter never really mentioned her opinion of her grandfather, but she never used the last name of Stalin in any literature. Stalin's second son, Vasily Dugashvili, mostly cared about using his father's name to get ahead in the world. He had seven children, and not much is known about them, but it is known that they changed their last names. Stalin has also had a daughter named Svetlana Dugashvili. She changed her last name to her mother's maiden name after Stalin died and defected to the US in the 1960s. She even stated that she would always be a political prisoner of her father's legacy. In the US, she even married once again, and her last name became Peters. She even had three children of her own. Not much is known about the first two children, but her youngest daughter was born as Olga Peters and then changed to Shrice Evans. She's a Buddhist and she owns an antique shop in Oregon. So putting aside the fact that he was responsible for tens of millions of deaths, his own family denounced him. So yes, I would argue Stalin is pretty much that bad. He was a terrible leader, a terrible husband, and a terrible father.